वी कैन स्टार्ट मैम, वी कैन स्टार्ट।
गुड मॉर्निंग। सो टुडे आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू द 17th शिक्षा अनुसंधान एकेडमिक लेक्चर ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय आवर डिपार्टमेंट। सो टुडेज टॉपिक ऑफ द वेबिनार इज एंड प्लस टू डायनामिक प्रोसेस इन माइक्रो कंटीन्यूम लेयर। And we have as our speaker Dr. Mrugang Sekhar Chatti. Dr. Mrugang Sekhar Chatti is currently holding a postdoctoral position at the Department of Mechanical Engineering, IIT Kanpur. Dr. Chatti pursued his MSc and PhD from the Department of Mathematics and Computing at IIT ISB Kanpur. He completed his PhD in mathematics from University of Calcutta, Kolkata. His areas of research interest are vibroacoustic study of Indian musical instruments, elastic wave propagation, microcontinuum mechanics, smart structures, analytical methods, and numerical simulations. Dr. Chatti has published 10 research articles in international journals such as International Journal of Mechanical Sciences, European Journal of Mechanics and Solids, Mathematics and Mechanics of Solids, Mathematical Modeling in Applied Sciences. He has also contributed to 2 book chapters and collaborative work with Professor Viktor Eremeyev, Gdansk University of Technology, Poland. Dr. Chatti is an active reviewer of 4 international journals. He received a national award in mathematical sciences at 107th Indian Science Congress 2020. He has presented papers and delivered talks at several international conferences and congresses. He is also a life member of the Indian Science Congress, ISTM, and the Indian Mathematical Society. Now I welcome Dr. Chatti to deliver his talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the nice presentation, nice introduction. And I hope I'm audible to everyone.
Yes.
Yes. So let me share my screen. Is it visible to everyone?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay. Okay. So first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Shalini Shaha for inviting me, and also the other faculty members for considering my talk in this excellent webinar session. Today I will be presenting an elastodynamic problem in microcontinuum layered structure. So this is a work published in Mathematical Methods in Applied Science. And this work I have done during my PhD at IIT ISM. Right now I'm at IIT Kanpur and I'm working on something else. I'm working on musical instruments. I'm studying acoustic vibration using this simulations and green function approach and all that. So today I will be talking about, I will introduce this microcontinuum layer structure, which is very interesting. And it's a completely new world for the people of mechanics and applied mathematicians. So let me start with what is this elastodynamic problem. So elastodynamic problem is something that deals with elastic wave propagation. So any dynamic system, any dynamic problem you have, so if it concerns with elastic waves, then you have this type of problem. There are several types of elastic waves, and one of them is bulk wave, also known as the body wave. Another one is surface wave, and you have interfacial wave. So these waves can be understood in context of seismology. So if you consider that this is the Earth structure, and somewhere on the surface, we have a seismic station where you have a seismograph and it's reading all kinds of earthquake seismic waves. So somewhere in the other part of the Earth, we have a source. There's a starting of this earthquake, and maybe due to tectonic movement or maybe due to some kind of other artificial way, their waves are generated. So there will be two type of waves that will be generated. So the first wave that's generating at the source, that will go through the Earth system, that is the body force. There is a body wave, and that is reaching to this seismic station. Okay, and the another one that will hit the top of the surface directly, which is known as the epicenter, that you might have heard. And this epicenter, surface wave will be generated, and it will just propagate. So this surface wave is coming on the top of the surface, and it's hitting this seismic station. So you have two type of waves you are receiving at this seismic station. So you can imagine which one is faster. Obviously, body wave is faster, right? So in the seismic wave, you have this type of graphs. So the first graphs, they're very small scale. These are body waves that's coming very fast. And then you have the surface wave. You see the oscillation pattern here. So you obviously understand why the surface waves are more destructive. So all this earthquake, you see all this destruction, you see that is due to surface wave. So we have two types of surface wave. That is a Rayleigh wave and you have Love wave. So Rayleigh wave is something that you can consider this structure as a half space. So half space means it's a semi-infinite medium. So based on that surface, if you consider that your respective point, then you see that it's going to infinity with respect to the surface. So you can consider this as a semi-infinite structure. And Rayleigh wave is something that you have a vertical motion and you have a horizontal motion. So based on that, you have a kind of a elliptic retrograde motion. Okay. So here you have this kind of a anti-clockwise retrograde motion. And that is the Rayleigh wave. And this is similar to the pattern that you see if you go to the sea and you see that waves are coming to it. So you can feel this kind of a rotational motion, this retrograde motion. So this anti-clock motion is called the retrograde. The opposite one is the prograde motion. There is a clockwise motion. And one of the examples is gravity wave that you see outside the Earth structure that's in the universe. Another type of wave that I will be talking, and it is much more simpler, is called the Love wave. And it is named after A.H.E. Love. So this type of wave is basically a horizontally polarized shear wave. The polarization is a kind of a property that wave in the wave characteristic that we see. So it is stuck in the horizontal plane and it has a zigzag motion. You can see in the picture here. So what is the difference here? So Rayleigh wave have both motions, like in plane motion, and the Love wave has only anti-plane motion. This is a zigzag motion. Okay, so if you have like U, V, W, this three particle motion. So for the Rayleigh wave, you have U and W. And for the Love wave, you have only V. So both terms will not be here because of the anti-plane nature. And another difference is that Rayleigh wave only needs a half space, but this Love wave needs a layer, a superficial layer. But in reality, you will see both of these waves together in the seismograph reading, because Earth structure itself is a multi-layered structure, right? So you go down and down and you see that different types of layers that you can see, the asthenosphere and everything you have. So in reality, you have a mixed kind of waves. But to study our present problem, we will consider this only this Love wave, which is much more simpler in mathematics. Okay, we talk about this layer half space configuration, but not necessarily there that it has a planar boundary. You can have a certain irregularity. So here, if we consider some sort of irregularity, but we consider this irregularity with very small perturbation. Now, once we introduce this perturbation, the mathematics become complicated. You cannot really use numerical simulations. Like MATLAB will fail if you consider this a singular perturbation. So this type of perturbation, if you use, this geometry will be arbitrary. So you see that I have considered this x equals to epsilon hy, where epsilon is the arbitrary, this perturbation parameter, and hy is the arbitrary geometrical shape. And for this small span, like minus d by 2 to d by 2, it's very small. So for that, you have this fy function, and that could be arbitrary shape. It could be corrugated, it could be any type of shape. And if you replace this function with a known geometry, for example, rectangle, parabolic, and triangular knot shape, then you will be able to figure out the mathematics of it. You'll be able to figure out what type of nature you may have in case of wave characteristics. So what is the traditional way? How do we solve this type of elastodynamic problem? We construct this mathematical model, which is basically a boundary value problem. And then we assume a time harmonic solution. In some cases, we assume space harmonic solution. And then this assumed solution will contain some arbitrary coefficients. And we eliminate them using the boundary condition. That's what we do. And after eliminating, we can have the field variable expression, maybe in terms of integrals, maybe in terms of algebraic expression. And we also have a dispersion relation, which shows the nature of the wave that explains the behavior of the wave characteristics. And then we can do the numerical study. So that is how we go through. So first of all, let me introduce this microcontinuum model. So you see that I've told you this kind of earth structure. So in this kind of earth structure, we consider isotropic material, which is very classical elasticity that we consider here, but not in any generalized cases. You see, the first we have, let me just introduce this microcontinuum model first. So we have Edingen, which is a pioneer in the field of microcontinuum theory. And also, I'm pointing out a statement given by Mojine. So I'm honored to be part of IIT ISM Solid Mechanics Group because Professor Amaresh Chattopadhyay, which is a supervisor of Dr. Shainili Shah, he has worked with Professor Mojine, who has recently passed in 2017. And he's one of the pioneers in this field. So he also pointed out, and also Edingen have pointed out, that you have this continuum theory, which you have this classical continuum theory, and based on which you have all the engineering fields. Based on that, you have all the geophysics problem, the physics problem, and everything. But what if we are able to construct a continuum theory that also have a relation with the sub-level characterization, that is the nanoscale or the microscale? So you can imagine that this is a classical case. Okay, so I hope you're able to see my cursor here. So you have this geometrical point, and this is the reference configuration that before the deformation, and after the deformation, that is the actual configuration, the point displaces, right? So you have, if you consider this degree of freedom, then it has a 3 degree of freedom in classical elasticity. So that UVW, that's the translation degree of freedom. But if we consider some sort of micro level particle interaction, then what you have is these particles become big enough that their microscale size is big enough so that we can consider them as their own continuum. Okay, so first of all, we can consider rotational degree of freedom. Why? Because these particles are surrounded by other particles. So once there is a deformation, it will not only show the translation, but it will also show a rotational. So basically, I'm considering particles as a rigid body dynamics. So these particles have rigid body dynamics. Okay? And due to the neighboring particle effect, it will have this rotational degree of freedom. So these rotational degree of freedom, they are also represented as the directors. So these DIs, these are the directors. It can be orthogonal, it can be orthonormal based on the different microcontinuum theories. So we have these fast microcontinuum theories and how they have developed. Edingen is the person who has monographed it very and well documented it, all the continuum microcontinuum theories. So we have classical theory where there are no directors. We only have 3 degree of freedom. Then you have micropolar theory, where we introduce extra 3 degree of freedom, that is the rotational degree of freedom. So in total, you have 6 degree of freedom. Then in this case, these directors are orthonormal. Okay? And then you have microstress theory, where these directors will become orthogonal. So you have a stretching component. That's why it's called stretching. It means these directors are they can contract, they can expand. So there's a stretching component involved. And then you have micromorphic theory, where these each particles have their own continuum system. So the degree of freedom is 12 here in this case. Okay, so these are some of the people that are working on this field. Professor Zilin is the person who has tremendously worked on this theory to try to generalize it. Then you have Elena Bisheskova. Then you have Professor Erimaev. I was fortunate enough to work with Professor Erimaev and published a paper, this paper, that is published in last year. And I have also worked on this micropolar solids. And also you have Professor Mueller here, who is also working on this type of structure. So that is the micro. So we'll be considering this micropolar theory, and the material that I will be talking today is a subcategory of that. It's called the reduced Kosarat theory. So the Kosarat brothers are the first person in 1909 who gave this idea that we should able to consider this coupled stress motion. We should able to consider other rotational degree of freedom. But this idea in 1909, it has been discarded. It is not very popular. But after 50 years, this idea, then it has discovered by many researchers. And then Erinjian done what he has done. And that's why it opened a new path completely. Okay, so let me give you some of the example why it is necessary to talk about this Kosarat model or micropolar model. So one of the engineering example that you can be interested in is the narrow crusher. You can imagine there are some granular materials, and due to this gravity, the path that it's going out is very narrow and it's crushing. So it's a crusher. And initially you can have this, these are not necessarily spherical, spherical structure they have, the spherical particles, but you can apply homogenization and then you can, you are able to do it. So as it is getting crushed, the size are getting reduced. And that's why the inertia is getting changed. Okay, so if we consider micro inertia in this system, then we'll be able to find our results matching with the experimental values. Otherwise, it will not match. So there are other examples like Zilin B tensor, electric polarization. Ether is something that we all know it has been discarded. Because this electromagnetic waves, these light waves, they can travel in vacuum. They do not need any material, right? So that's why ether has been discarded. But right now, ether is considered using this micropolar theory, which is very interesting, and it's giving you one of the answer to the question that can we consider Maxwell equation mechanically? Okay, so let me not go to that thing. Okay, and another example is rotational seismology. That is my focus here. Rotational seismology is something that we consider all these seismic dynamics, and we consider rotational degree of freedom or rotational variation to that system. So Professor Elena and their colleagues, they have studied this reduced Kosarat medium, which I will be talking now. And they have proved that it can be considered as a single negative acoustic metamaterial. And I will talk about what is a metamaterial very briefly. There are other examples like magnetic material, which is a Kelvin material, which have this spinning tensor. And there are other materials which have this gyration vectors and all that. So the most interesting thing is the metamaterial. And I will first talk about optical metamaterials because it is very intriguing. So you see that if you consider any object, for example, this apple here, and light source is coming and it's hitting the apple. Now, if we enclose this apple with this metamaterial structure, then what happens is that due to this metamaterial property, what's a metamaterial? It's a periodic arrangement of materials. So due to this periodic arrangement, whenever a wave is passing through, they show some kind of properties which you cannot see in classical materials. That's why it's called meta. Meta means something out of ordinary. So one of the property is that you can have a negative shear modulus. So it's one of the things. So Lamé parameters, if you worked on the mechanics, this lambda and mu, they are coming. They can have negative values. So it's one of the great example in metamaterials. Then right now in University of Liverpool and Southampton, and also Oxford and USA, they are also working on this metamaterials. And why it is interesting is because you see that these light waves, for example, is an electromagnetic wave, the light wave, and it can bend. Why it is bending? Because this metamaterial also show a property of band gaps, which I will talk about. So this due to this band gap, these light waves are bending, and it's coming to your eyes. So what you're seeing here, this apple, which is completely surrounded by this metamaterials, you see that light waves are coming behind it, and you see whatever the image behind this apple you're seeing here, right? So basically, this apple will become invisible. You cannot see this. So it's one of the application of the optical metamaterials. That is the invisibility cloak. If you know the Harry Potter movies and all that, you see that they used to have this invisible cloak. You put it in your put it as a cloth, and people will not be able to see. So it's one of the science fiction that these researchers are trying to make it real. Okay, so another example is the seismic metamaterials. That is my concern. So you see that this light is bending due to this band gap. And if we put this seismic meta barriers before the earthquake is hitting these our major cities, major buildings, and they will be able to bend this light, and they will be able to make this surface wave bulk wave, that is the body wave that's going inside the earth structure. So in a sense, we will be able to control this seismic destruction. But there are a lot of works that needs to be done, and people are also working on it. One of the natural metabarriers or the natural metamaterials are forest. If you see the forest, the trees are arranged in such a periodic structure that these waves are coming, and they will act as a natural metabarrier. So they will be able to reduce this intensity of this seismic waves. Okay, so this is the model that I want to talk about. This is the reduced Cosrat model. So I told you here that these material particles are getting affected by these neighboring particles. So you have this rotation. What if we just discard the neighboring particle rotation? So what you have is the translation vectors. You have the rotation vector of that observing particles, but you are discarding the rotation of the neighboring particles. So you do not have a change in the or the gradient in the theta, that is the gradient in the rotation, that is absent in this case, in this material. So in that case, you do not have coupled stress. You only have stress or the Cauchy stress that we consider. But you have a momentum equation, and you also have the balance equation, that is the Newton's second law that is coming to the picture. So you have all these things, you have a micro inertia and everything. You just do not have the coupled stress in this case, that is absent. So which is a reduced form, and mathematically, it is a way advantageous to work on this type of structure. And this model, currently Professor Elena Grekova at St. Petersburg, Russia, she is also working on it, and I have been in contact with her. So today I will be talking about this kind of model. So I told you about love wave. It needs this kind of layer half space situation. Instead of considering isotropic material, the classical elasticity, we consider this material, that is the reduced Cosrat material. This type of material you can see in a heterogeneous structure or a blocky geomedium structure or this granular structure that I have shown you. So this type of rotational particle is, and it is also very realistic because the earth structure is full of granular materials and full of heterogeneity. So it is not very good to consider this earth structure as a homogeneous structure. So yeah, and also we are considering this irregular boundary or this perturbed boundary that I have also told you. We consider this perturbed at the top of the surface for very finite span. So our problem is this love wave, this zigzag motion, this antiplane wave is coming from the left side, this is the incident wave, and it's falling at the region of this irregular boundary, and it's getting scattered in every direction. Okay, so this is the scattered field, but We obviously can study this scattered field in the right hand side, in the low side, and along this singularity that will be happening in the boundary. But we will be deriving the mathematical expression for the reflected fields that is coming back from this this irregular boundary. Professor Barry Wolf is the first person in 1970. He has given a technique which has been used for this kind of irregular boundary, and he has used this for isotropic case. But we can use this for this reduced Coussard isotropic medium, and one of the expectation of this result is that we should be able to find the band gap that I have told you, which is a major key for this metamaterial structure. So this work has been published in Mathematical Methods in Applied Sciences last year. So if you consider this antiplane motion, so I told you, you have V here, and based on that, you have theta, that is, so it has a left-hand rule, right? So this couple stress is a left-hand rule, so you have theta 1 and theta 3. So for that, you have this equation of motion, which is reduced from the from this equation of motion. This is a balance law. So you have this this equation, and for the upper irregular boundary, I told you that this is the equation, and fx is still unknown. So I have given this arbitrary shape. Okay, so the boundary condition is that at the top of the surface, we have this irregular boundary, and here the stress is free. So this upper stress, which is affected by this irregular boundary here, it's not balancing with anything because the upper side is vacuum. There's no material in there. But at the interface of the layer and half space, we have stress continuity and displacement continuity. So this is getting balanced here. So that is our boundary condition, and this is our equation of motion. So as for the solution, so next what we consider is the solution, right? So we consider this a solution for the incident wave first. So incident wave means it hasn't hit this irregular boundary. So it is on the left hand side. So it has a flat boundary until now. So before it hitting the irregular boundary, we have this V theta and theta 3 and V2, theta 2 and theta 3 for the half space. And we can consider this type of solution with arbitrary coefficients. And we see that for the upper layer, we have the sinusoidal case. But for the half space, we have this exponential, which is decaying. Why? Because this is half space. So as you go along the depth, you should not have this surface wave, because the surface wave only exists on the surface. So you should have this kind of radiation condition, or the case where these waves are attenuating as we go along the depth. So if you consider this stress continuity, this one, so using this boundary, and if you consider the solution, this is a simple case that you can solve it. So you will be able to get this kind of relation, which is a dispersion relation. So dispersion relation is something that tell you what is the nature of this wave, and what is the relation between this frequency of the wave with the wave number. This love wave has a condition that here S1 has to be greater than S2, means the wave speed has to be greater than the bulk speed of the layer and less than the bulk speed of the half space. Only then this love wave will propagate. Otherwise, you have another type of wave called the Bluestein-Gulai wave. You have also Rayleigh wave. It has a other condition. It is not also dispersive in this case, but this love wave is dispersive in this particular situation. So this is the dispersion relation for the incident wave. Now the wave is hitting the irregular structure. So there you have this kind of singularity that is to the integral, because you will be able to find this singularity. So it will give you some branch cut, and you will be able to figure out this contour by carefully excluding these branch points. Okay, so the radicals here, and this based on this, you can plot a. So this KSC plane is the wave number for this scatter part. Okay, so this KSC, in the KSC plane, due to this radical, you have this branch points. So it is giving a four-fold Riemann sheet that that we are considering. So in this case, between this minus S1 to minus S2 and S2 to S1, you have this branch cut. And you can consider the contour around this branch cuts. Okay, so that is the thing we'll be doing. So in total displacement field, we have this incident that's coming from the left, and then you have the scattered part that is considering this irregular boundary. So if you combine them, you have the total displacement field, and you can also find the total rotational fields. Next, what you do, due to this perturbation method, we can use, due to this perturb boundary, you can use this perturbation method. What is a perturbation method? You basically express any type of variable with the form of this summation, where this epsilon will be epsilon, not epsilon zero, that is one plus epsilon square plus epsilon q, and so on. And you can consider the first order of epsilon. So you you use this perturbation on this A1. So you see that you have different type of arbitrary constants, A and A1. But if you use this perturbation, if you consider the first order epsilon, then this A1, yes, we are considering A1R. So you have A11, A12, A13. So if you consider first order, you only have A11, right? So you can replace this A11 by using this boundary condition 5, that is the stress-free condition. That's the upper surface you have. So for the stress-free condition, you can use that boundary condition. And this A11, you can express it in terms of this expression, where A is the same as this one. So if you combine them, you have the only single arbitrary coefficients that is coming for both incident and the scattered part. But we are not done yet. We still it is still in integral form. And this contour needs to be evaluated for both V1 and V2, as well as for the thetas. So first, we notice that it has poles, because this integral, you cannot evaluate it until you determine these poles. So how you determine the pole? By making the denominator zero. So you have the same denominator for the layer and half space for V1 and V2, the displacement components. If you make it zero, then from this cos and sine terms, you have this tan and you have this right hand side terms. And if you plot this structure here, plot this equation here, then you will be able to find n such zero poles that is between this minus S1 to S2, and on the right hand side you have S2 to S1, because there's a sign of the plus minus sign. Okay, so we can we need to consider we need to evaluate this integral. So we already have this contour integration. Well, what we need is just one half circle, right? And we consider this careful cut in the contour, and we also have this the branch cut at the imaginary axis. Why? Because if we consider omega, that is your frequency, in complex values, then this then you have an equation. You can look into the monograph given by Ewing et al. And they have given a very nice description of it. So you will have a rectangular hyperbola on this second gradient and the fourth gradient, fourth quadrant. So this rectangular hyperbola is coming when you have a omega as the complex value. But if you consider omega as real, you have to remember that k is still complex. But if you consider omega as real, then this rectangular hyperbola falls in this on this axis. And then you have this branch cut here. Okay, so what you do is you take this cut and take the C infinity, that is the radius of that circle, and you take a branch cut around this imaginary axis, that's up to going up to minus S2 around it. So in total, if you consider this one as T1 and this one as T2, then the contour integration will be residue of that of the all the of the function, which can be easily calculated using the poles that we have talked about, then minus this branch cut B, right? And then you have this C infinity. You also exclude that. And that is also true for T2 again. So you can calculate this residue of T1, you can calculate residue of T2. And this C infinity, you know that it will blow up once you do the contour and once you make the radius to infinity. And then you have this branch, you have this branch cut, and that branch cut can be analytically deduced by using this relation. This is also known as the Sezawa technique. Sezawa technique. Sezawa is the person in Tokyo University, and he has done some works on this this type of singularity, this type of irregularity structure in this earthquake situation. So he has given he has pointed out this relation. You can derive this relation using Laplace transformation or gamma function or anything. This is a very simple relation here. And you see that if you use that, then this T1, only this part, the integral of the B, the contribution is x to the power minus 3 by 2, right? And for the T2, you again have x to the power minus 3 by 2, but you also have a Z term. So that Z term is here, that e to the power minus s2z by root Z. Now, we are focusing not only on the perturbed boundary case, but we are focusing away from it. So we want to study what is the wave field, the nature of the wave field, if it is scattered and it is going away from this perturbed boundary. So in that case, your x and z, that both are becoming very large. So in that way, this contribution of this integrand is very small as compared to the residue of this T1 and T2. So we can discard it somehow. So if you do that, then we can, so remember, it is still in integrand. You have outside minus infinity to infinity. That is the integrand still there. We can divide it into minus infinity to x and x to infinity. You have also y variable. So there should be a relation between y and x, whether it should be y is greater than x and y is less than x. So based on that, you have this system. So we can study reflected field, that is x is less than far less than minus s by 2, that is on the left hand side of this perturbed boundary. And we can also consider x far greater than s by 2, that is on the right hand side, that is the completely scattered field. So we are considering only reflected field. You can also study the scattered field. So if you consider that, then we have this type of relation here. I see that this integral still needs to be evaluated. This Fy, because Fy is still unknown in this case. And we can also find this big expression for the microrotational components. Okay, and this is the monstrous equations that we need to deal with somehow. So in all this system, this you see that you have a summation here that's due to the n poles. And you also have this integral that still, it's very ugly, this equations. So it needs to be have a very nice algebraic expression. So what we do, we consider a simple cases. So first of all, we consider that out of these poles, we consider only first wave field. So M will become one. So this summation, we'll consider the first wave mode. And the next, what we do, this Fy, these are unknowns. So this Fy, I told you, we assign some known geometry. So we can consider rectangle, parabolic, and triangular knot shape. So if you do that, then for the rectangular shape, we have this Hx given here, where this is a constant. So there is the span of that. And if we apply that in the field variables, so V and theta and theta 1 and theta 2, then we have this nice algebraic expression. You see that this algebraic expression, this field variable, depend on this term. And this term is basically, it has a S, which is a notch depth. And you see that from there, you are able to find a relation between this notch depth and this field variable. And you are also able to find a no propagation phenomena if you consider them as zero. And if you consider this sine KS as zero, you see that you will be able to find S is n lambda by 2, where lambda is the wavelength. That means when the length of the notch is an even integral multiple, because you need to have even, otherwise it will not be a fraction. Then it has to be even integral multiple of the wavelength. Then you can have this no reflection. That means on those cases you have no reflection coming from this perturbed boundary. Similarly, you can have a parabolic shape boundary, and you can use this parabolic equation. And if you put that in this variable, field variable, then you will be able to find this kind of structure, this kind of equation. And you see that here it is a type of an implicit equation. So calculating no deflection phenomena is a little tough, but you can figure out, you can draw a figure that explains the behavior of this V and S. And for triangular notch shaped irregularity, you have this kind of equation. And if you put that again in the field variable, then you have this nice expression. And you have the very simpler form, just like the rectangular case. And you see that there is a no reflection phenomena when it is a just an integral multiple of that wavelength. So we should be able to validate our results, what we have established. So we see that we have, if you consider this, if you discard this micro rotational components, okay, so we discard this rotational behavior, then what we get from the dispersion relation from both the incident and the scattered field, so it's not hitting any perturbed boundary, it's going straight, it's propagating straight away. So there you have this dispersion relation, and which is a classical case of Love wave equation given by A.H.E. Love. And if you can, in this case, these displacement components will be like this. And for particularly, if you have, if you consider this perturbed boundary, then in the perturbed boundary, if we give a known geometry, for example, triangular knot shape irregularity, you have this relation. And this relation exactly we deduced from our equation, and it has been given by Wolf in 1970, the Barry Wolf that I've shown the paper. Now, if you consider some data some new, for the numerical analysis, so we see that if you draw this dispersion curve for the scattered field, we see that in normally in classical case, this red line, it used to be a continuous one, it used to be a straight line. But here you see that it has been split into two parts. This is due to the critical frequency, that is omega naught and omega 1. And these critical frequencies are coming to the picture. So that's why it's splitting it. So in between that, you have a no propagation zone, or it's also called the band gap that I told you. So due to this band gap, we see this wave bending, and we see that all this kind of very important phenomena in metamaterials. That's why the Professor Elena Grekova also studied this reduced cosine material as the acoustic metamaterial that can be used for that. So the same thing we can see in displacement field. If you plot the displacement field, we say that for the isotropic case, it is very periodic in nature, obviously, but we do not have such kind of band gap. But if we put our singularity at a particular point due to our data, then we see that we do have this kind of a band gap situation. So yeah, and we also drawn graphs for the rectangular shape irregularity. We also studied this vertical irregularity irregular parameter, that is epsilon by h, is a non-dimensional one, and we see the effect of that. And we see that we also have a band gap here for the parabolic shape irregularity. We have a very strong band gap here, and again for the triangular knot shape irregularity, we again see the same thing. So as for the conclusion, we see that we are considering this Cosaret layer, which is periodic in nature, and we are studying the reflected fields. We can also study the scattered field. One of the highlight is that we are able to find this discontinuity due to this critical frequency in the amplitude profiles. And we see that it is more in case of rotational components as compared to the displacement one. We also find a relation between the width with the amplitude profile. We also find relation with the notch length with the amplitude profile. And we also see the no deflection phenomena for the rectangle, parabolic, and triangular knot shape irregularity. We also see we have also seen that there is a relation between the vertical irregularity parameter and the amplitude profiles. And another highlight is that we see that this reflected fields, the amplitude profiles, are these the amplitudes are maximum in case of rectangular shape irregularity. Then it is a little bit less for the parabolic, and then a little bit less for the triangle. And if you consider the same span, you see that if you have a this rectangle shape irregularity, it occupies the maximum region. Then if you have a parabolic shape irregularity, then it occupies less. And then you have a triangle, you have again it's less region is there. So it also justifies with the geometrical shape what we are achieving here. And as the validation, if you make the macrorotational components go away, then we have this kind of isotropic structure. So thank you very much. I hope that was interesting. And if you have any question, then please let me know.
Dr. Chaki, I have a small query that are reduced coarserate layer and the heterogeneous layer are same or it is different?
No, no, no. Heterogeneity, if you consider the classical case that we use the heterogeneous structure, if you consider isotropic model maybe, then we see that there are a different type of heterogeneity, like exponential heterogeneity or the sinusoidal heterogeneity and like that. So what they are doing is they are considering as we go along the depth, okay, if it is a function of this depth axis.
Depth.
The x-axis.
Yes.
Yeah. So if you go along the depth, then the property is changing.
Yes,
that is
definitely
what we are considering. But not in this case. We are considering the whole thing as heterogeneous structure, the heterogeneous model.
In every direction, the changes
yes,
can be.
Yes, yes. So this particle behavior, they are affected by this heterogeneity.
Okay.
So the whole continuum model has been changed. It's not at all isotropic. It's a microcontinuum theory.
Okay.
Once the theory is completely changed, everything, the balance equation, the Cauchy relations, everything is changed there.
Constitutive so relation, like.
Yeah, exactly. So okay. You see that the heterogeneity is inspired from the same thing, but this is completely different. It's not a classical case.
Sure,
you're considering
yes.
the full heterogeneous structure. That is.
And one more question. How do this couple stress arise in any medium?
So couple stress is basically, it is affected by neighboring particles that I've told you. So
yes.
if you consider a rigid body motion, then you know there are the momentum equations. You normally
yes.
express this in terms of the curl of, yeah. So you express this in terms of momentum, right? So you have a moment equation. And also in case of classical elasticity, you do have moment equations.
Yes, sir.
Right. So if you introduce this rotational components, then this whole couple stress theory is coming to the picture that do not appear in case of a classical elasticity.
Okay.
So that is the difference there.
Any
Thank other
you very
questions?
Much.
Thank you, Shalini.
Any other questions from the audience?
So I hope everyone is happy with my presentation because this work is very intriguing and very state of
yeah.
the art. It's a very future trend that we are working on it, and I hope to be able to do many more papers on it because that is a very interesting phenomenon, especially the optical metamaterials, the invisibility cloak that we see in case of this thing.
Dr. Chaki, I have one question. In while explaining the reduced Coarserate model,
yeah.
you
yes.
mentioned that couple stress will be negligible or not required.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
could you please explain that?
So you see that this theory comes from the micropolar theory. Okay. So the couple stress is actually this is a, if you derive this expression for the couple stress. So it's coming, that is the displacement field. And you do have the theta, but it is in the gradient form. So grad of theta will be coming in case of a couple stress. So if you derive that, you have this grad of theta. And we are considering in this theory that the neighboring particle, they do not change the rotation, they do not change the change of rotation. That is the gradient of theta, the gradient of rotation. Okay. So that is what we are considering. So if you do that, that means the grad of theta is zero. And if you put that in the equation, the couple stress will become zero. But I'm not saying that the moment is not there. You have a moment of the balance of the momentum. That equation is there. But the couple stress is not happening. You have only Cauchy stress. So that is the difference there. That's why it's called reduced form. It's not the coarserate form.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. Thank you. Audience, do you have any questions? Any more questions? If you don't have any questions, then let me express vote of thanks. We thank the speaker, Dr. Digankar Shekhar Chaki, for his wonderful talk and presentation. And our thanks are due to the colleagues, scholars, and students in the audience. Our big thank goes to Dr. Manoj Ranjan Nayak, the Honorable President of Shiksha Anusandhan DMTB University, who have been always a source of inspiration to all of us. I extend our thanks to Professor Sunita Chan, the Acting Head of the Center for Applied Mathematics and Computing, and Professor Manjula Das, the Head of the same center, for the necessary supports. Lastly, I, on behalf of the Center for Applied Mathematics and Computing, Shiksha Anusandhan DMTB University, extend our heartfelt thanks to all. So thank you, Dr. Chaki, once again for this wonderful presentation.
Thank you very much.
Okay, namaste. Thank you. Officially, I'm ending the meeting and as well as the recording. Thank you all.
Take care. Bye.
Thank you.